Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I think you are strong enough to do it alone, chairing this session. Thanks also to the organizing committee for having invited me. And of course, finally, thanks to you, dear colleagues, because apparently you didn't need the ancient Japanese drums to wake you up. So I highly appreciate it. In this presentation on veterinary herd health and productivity management on dairy farm, the subtitle of "It's a necessity, it's more important than what is listed above it." Because I will use the veterinary herd health and productivity management programs as a skeleton, as well as quality risk management as a skeleton, to present you with other slides which have indirectly to do with these two programs, and which maybe are sometimes provocative for you, just showing you the constraints and where the hurdles are when you want to implement this type of programs. As an introduction, probably you will know the history of herd fertility schemes in the late 60s, early 70s, which were popping up, for example, in Australia. I think they were the first to do so. Standalone program, not paying attention to other farming domains like nutrition or udder health. And the other way, udder health control programs were developed given the level of prevalence of mastitis, clinical and subclinical mastitis. And they were developed for the pure reason to try to control them in a better way. And of course, we know the herd vaccination plans, either as a blind blanket vaccination plan or in any situation where vaccination came into the picture. Standalone. No opening the scope to see whether there are farming domains which are relevant for the implementation of either one of these. As a result, we have seen years afterwards that farmers dropped out. They didn't get what they expected, or they didn't even see any progress, for example, in herd fertility. They always complained at that period that calving intervals remained the same, was no improvement visible. And, not in the least, vets were not performing as expected. For example, the reason for dropping out farmers was that in herd fertility schemes, the vets like to do the rectal palpations, uterus, ovaries, and so on, but not the data analysis, because that cost time and time investment. And then in the 80s, the herd health and productivity management programs were introduced, who were supposed to integrate the different farming domains into one program, which is implemented rather from the point of view of the farmers instead of point of view of the vets. That was a major changeover, and the history showed that over the past 30 years, at least, those programs are being applied left and right in different countries. In many instances, the contents may vary, but the program bases are still similar. European College of Bovine Health Management, trying to yield European acknowledged specialist, has worked on a blueprint model for herd health and production management. I don't know exactly this date how far they are. I know that there are several veterinary schools in Europe who have their log, their herd health and productivity management log, especially for students, but also for practitioners. Small booklets where every farming domain is addressed from a herd health and productivity management point of view. That helps a lot, because integrating the different farming domains is easy to say, but not so easy to apply. We have seen the computer support systems developing in a more sophisticated way. I remember the days of John Fetterow in the US and several programmers in vet schools in Europe. It had nothing to do with what we can see today in programs available for farmers and for vets. Of course, social media play an increasing role in trying to get the message over much more rapidly and much more concise. Yet, those programs are not as widely implemented as, in my view, they should be. What is the reason for that? Why should it be implemented more widely? Well, there are very studies who have proven the economic benefits of for the farmer and, of course, then also for the vet. Various countries have seen the consultation of the vet for sick cows, so to say, going down, less income for the vet. Other countries, we have seen that the farmer can do different handlings and treatments himself, so no income from the vet neither. But these programs have proven profit by implementation. There are socio-economic benefits for the farmer, a better status in the community, which is linked to job satisfaction of the farmer. He feels more at ease because he needs someone to look over his shoulder. Imagine a farmer in an average situation has to handle every day about 400 processes and functions. We know that from developing a computer program where you have to decide on which functions and processes are going on the farm. So job satisfaction is a very important issue for the farmer. An improved client-veterinarian bond, and not in the least, it has been established that these programs contribute to sustainable dairy production, which these days is rather important as well. But what hampers then the implementation? Unfortunately, there is a large variation between curricula, veterinary curricula, in the different countries. There are still curricula where students do not learn anything at all about applied herd health and productivity management. There are even, on the other side, curricula where herd health has been cut out as a reason of financial problems in a vet school. Imagine in what context that may be related to a strategic vision of the veterinary school. There's a large variation in attitude and mentality of both veterinary practitioners and farmers. So we have a socio-psychological problem there at both sides. And in many cases, the veterinarians see competition instead of potentials and working in a team. He or she might think that the AI will take over fertility and that the nutritionist take over other things. So there is a continuing perception problem and a continuing communication problem. I would say a problem of non-professionalism. Let's have a look at perception. These are results of study. You see clearly when farmers do not know what vets can provide them with, while the vets think that farmers are not interested in that, apparently they never spoke about it. I think that's mainly the vet who should place himself before the mirror and ask him, why do I think that farmers are not interested? Because he never interviewed his clients. There are no client questionnaires going around asking, what do you like to do? Where are your priorities? And at the same time, at the backside of the sheet, what can I provide as a service? Veterinarians are not trained whatsoever in marketing their services. Vets think that the programs are too costly for farmers. A farmer thinks that the veterinarians prefer to do the classical clinical handlings instead of going further as, say, a type of consultant. These are outcomes of a field study where apparently vets, I'm talking about the average vet, which do not exist, so there is a large variation, but they have not had training in professional communication. While, for example, in hospitals in the US and in medicine colleges, professional communication has become a clinical discipline for teaching. I do not know of any veterinary school, maybe in the UK it's starting, a veterinary school who has professional communication as a clinical teaching element. Vets are not able to market, they have not had any training. In general, they don't feel well when they talk about money and services. Especially, maybe vets can communicate about technical issues, zootechnical issues, veterinary technical issues, but they don't like to talk about irrational and maybe irrelevant issues. Not in the least, we have to think about the fact that there are periods where vets, say around 40, 45, have a burnout. Maybe are too tired to invest time in these programs. Maybe there are other reasons. Talking about human perception. The color of drugs, the red, yellow, and orange, are perceived as stimulating products. A red placebo had the same pain-killing effect as the other two with the molecule. At the same time, the blue and green perceived as calming down products, the blue pills had more effect as sleeping pills than the orange ones, even as a placebo. So there's something going on in the mind of people, humans, let's say veterinarians and farmers are part of human beings. A psychology of perception is subjective, a lot of emotions in there, and the perception of a farm situation by the farmer is not necessarily the same as the perception of that farm situation by the veterinarian. So you have to look for a common ground where discussion can take place on the same level. That's rather important for getting things done. What is often forgotten by the vet? The farmer identity profile, I call it, before starting a herd health program. Rational issues, we are familiar with that, farming goals, methodology, performance figures, evaluation. Usually there's no problem there. The problem is in the non-rational issues. How to deal with emotions? Do we know how a farmer reacts when we propose something? How does he perceive situations? What is his behavior? You better invest in that before starting off. Otherwise, there will be surprises. Dropping out the farmers. As a human being, a farmer, like a vet, likes to show his skills. If monitoring is implemented in a herd health program, body condition score, a simple example. If the average in the fresh cow group is good and the variation is little or non-existing, that you may make a note on your sheet, but it's even better to tell the farmer that he's done a good job. Because we have to be careful as a vet not only to point to negative points, and at the end of the day, at the end of the farm visit, the farmer thinks by himself, "Wow, there are a lot of negative points, I have done nothing good." It's only human, but we are not trained for it in general. As soon as the basic issue starts, you can, at a later stage, you can ask larger action and sacrifice by the farmer to do more. But it's a gradual process. You cannot impose a whole program as an avalanche on his head and say, do this, do that. Make sure the farmer is always the one who makes the decision, not us. So we have to think from the point of view of the farmer. Motivating areas. There are quite some areas which are motivating a farmer to keep on going. And as you can see, among these, there are several, not in the least animal health, animal welfare, where we are familiar to deal with those issues. Recognition, again, is a social or psychological issue. Farmers and vets both like to be recognized as people who are doing something and doing something good. Let's have a closer look. And there I will use the skeleton just in a gross overview. The herd is the basis, with farm management as the key, and not only the sick cow or the cow with certain disorders. Three pillars: routine monitoring, problem analysis, and prevention, based on the risk factors which come out of problem analysis. But routine monitoring is a simple practical tool to take the farmer along his cows and see whether you agree on the same issues: body condition, rumen fill, things like that. The farmers like it because in many instances it proves or confirms what they really have thought for themselves. And in other instances, you find things that he doesn't know of. It needs time, preparation time, farm visit time, after sales service. And for these three pillars, at least a farm report of one page for a small farm, or let's say a farm less than 200 cows, and maybe two pages for a big one. The writing style is telegram, short, no prosa, no one is reading a book, just practical, hot highlights. What have you done? What are your findings, conclusions, advice? The advice should be tailor-made for not only that farm, but for that specific manager or farmer. So you have to discuss it. You have to set priorities, and other advisors are put on the parking lot. I come to that. You need additional knowledge and skills of the vet. We should be more analytic in our approach. We should think in a process type of way. The colostrum management is, say, a well-known issue, but it speaks of the process part between birth of the calf and the changeover after the colostrum to replace a milling. It's a small process. Each part of that process has parameters to evaluate the situation. What is the IgG level in blood, or what is the quality of the colostrum itself? Can be measured, parameters used for evaluation. So we have to adopt another, more analytic approach. The discussion with the farmer is the most important. Finally, he should get an action plan which fits well into his management approach. Otherwise, he puts it aside, and then we are lost. Slow implementation, but steady. Not running in front of the farmer and he's getting behind. No, at least at the same pace as the farmer moves forward. Not implementing too much. The main advisors are the vet and a nutritionist on the farm. Advice should be harmonized. So instead of considering the nutritionist as an enemy, you better talk to the nutritionist and see whether for this client, his client, your client, it's the same. You cannot harmonize the advices. Exchange of information to the farm. Achievable goals. A calving interval of 415 days for the average in the herd. It's no use to put in a goal of 365 for the next year. Achievable. Assign responsibility to farm workers. Farm workers like to be responsible for something, and they know that if they are responsible, they will be evaluated for their performance. That makes even the teamwork on the farm itself more important. Continuously evaluate actions which are taken. That's nice, because our advisors follow up. But even important is, why are certain other ones not taken? Have you made a mistake, or are there constraints on the farm itself? Have to find that out. Compliance is another thing. Once an action plan has been established and the farmer agrees fully, then we should try to make him stick to that action plan. Compliance. Routine monitoring, I will be short and not treat everything, but it's a simple and practical, effective method to get information from animals, their environment and the management, and farm data. We find strong points and weak points in farm management. Everyone can do monitoring. Not everyone can do the interpretation of findings and, based on that, designing an action plan. That's the vet. It shows current or hidden problems in the herd and certain management failures. So it only monitoring alone, in the broad sense, is already a tool which is very practical and very appreciated by farmers, because it's talking about their herd, their management, and they are directly addressed by you. Examples, I will not go into detail. This is for the animals. Here are examples for the animal environment and the management and farm data. As you can notice, I have put rectal palpation issues here, not only because it addresses fertility in itself, but you can also use rectal palpation to have a clue about negative energy balance, for example, which can be confirmed by other monitoring parameters. This is, of course, far too much to do all at the same time. It's not needed neither. Some things need not to be done every month. So we have to organize what is important on this farm. Then I focus my parameters on that. And if it's not important for the time being, then I just leave it. Charts are all over. You find them in the internet, you find them in several books where they speak about applications. A process approach, birth to milk replacer. For example, just the calf pen, you have requirements. Requirements can be used as evaluation parameters. The same for the colostrum itself, colostrum management. You have requirements, and you have, at the same time, the evaluation parameters. Very handy to use these type of requirements, for example, the colostrum management, to develop protocols, especially on farms which are much larger, like you find in different places of the world. There, the protocols and standard operating procedures are a must. Just in short, an example of a basic analysis protocol in herd health programs say that there is a drop in pregnancy percentage over the last 3 months. These are potential causal areas, differential diagnosis. Then you start always with the routine monitoring without forgetting the case cows. But this is always a must to have an overview of the rest of the herd. Findings, step two, including the risk factors that you determine, interpretation, probability diagnosis, and your conclusions. And based on that, you have a plan of action, you discuss it with the farmer, and up, not more than five priorities. In sociological studies, I'm not talking about farmers or vets, it has been established that the average human being can handle five priorities maximum at the same time. So if you have other advisors, you put them on the parking lot for a later stage. If one has been executed, you can get from the parking lot another advice and put it in the top list of priorities. Flexible and dynamic approach. Always an evaluation. Maybe further analysis. And if needed, adjust the plan of action or your diagnosis. This is a continuing story month after month. To go out further, we skip, in the example, these three, and we keep the feed and feeding management as a potential, but we are not sure. This is the findings of monitoring with an emphasis on claw and leg problems, poor rumen fill scores. Your conclusion is a high prevalence of claw lesions, clinical and subclinical claw conditions, meaning that at the same time you find an insufficient feed intake of the cows because of poor rumen fill score, as indicated there. And maybe there is a negative energy balance problem because the feed intake has dropped because of claw problems, and that has a direct effect on reproductive performance. But we still have that question mark here. If the negative energy balance is suspected, you better check the milk recorder data, kilogram fat and protein, to find whether or not ketosis and rumen acidosis is suspected. Then these two come together. And then based on that, you determine an action plan regarding the prevalence of the claw lesions, and of course, if ketosis acidosis is suspected, there is the priority action one. I will skip the next one to get some time. What I meant to say is the whole process of herd health programs is flexible and dynamic, and we have to adapt ourselves to that dynamic. There is a special group of farmers which is not comparable to, say, the average farmer, the entrepreneurial farmers. They have a specific characteristic. If you don't give them information, they ask for it. If you don't give your analysis report, they ask for it. And probably they ask also for the documents where the whole analysis procedure has been done by you. They want to know how did you come to the conclusion, and if they subscribe the same arguments as you have used in your analysis. So you are speaking on a much equal level as the other one, the average farmer, because there are two experts discussing, the entrepreneurial farmer and you. It's a challenge. At the same time, it gives you a professional identity. I come to that later on. Market focus. That's a pity because we don't have it. Commercial focus. we have not had any teaching in commercial issues. Highly communicative, if we cannot adapt our communication in a more professional manner, then it's not easy to talk to them. They have a broad judgment and are not always satisfied with what you are saying. Okay, then you just ask from what's hampering. Keep on discussing, and you find a way to solve the problem in taking another route of approach. He doesn't care, as long as you stick to his problem and you show the effort and the compassion to find a way that addresses him in a more direct way, then you still have that strong relationship. Very nice people to work with, as the average farmer is also, but we have to adapt to the situation. The persistent compliance to an action plan is the key to success, but needs motivation and coaching. There again, there is that issue of sociology and psychology. How can we coach a farmer? Well, compare it to a football coach. There are successful coaches and there are non-successful coaches. What drives the successful one and what lacks in the non-successful one? The goal achievement is highly correlated with quality and cooperation in the team, veterinarian, nutritionist, farmer, and the level of compliance. In a Dutch study published in 2017, if the compliance indeed is sufficiently persistent, after 1 year, 70% of goals were achieved. So it's feasible if you are able to touch the right chord of the guitar of the farmer. Reasons for non-compliance: emotional and or non-rational behavior. Comes back to the farmer identity profile. Again, sociology, psychology. The perception, as we know now, is a high level of subjectivity. We have to find out how he reacts and why. Maybe a poor decision making could be on the basis of poor knowledge. In that case, we have to educate him. Why these factors are risk factors for that and that disorder. As soon as he understands, you can move a step further. If he doesn't understand, you are on the way to losing him. Poor self-confidence, it still exists. Poor risk assignment, because he has heard about some things, risk factors and disorders, but not 100% right. So again, a matter of education. Look always for the common grounds for discussion about risk explanation. Farmers should be educated like veterinarians should be educated. Risks in life, they exist. Sometimes they are manageable, sometimes they are not. Quality risk management, I'm not speaking about taste or smell or visual aspects, etc. I'm talking about production process orientations. Not product orientation on milk or meat, veal calves, but on production process orientations. Cut down the farming, the total farming process in smaller processes, just to visualize what's happening where and when. And then you can start with figuring out the disorders, animal health, welfare, public health issues, zoonoses, and food safety. Characteristics: hazards, that's disease disorders, and the risk factors related to them. Identify critical management points. We will see that critical management points are also used in herd health programs, only the name is different. Monitoring issues, the big table and the charts with pictures, basically are critical management points. Monitoring protocols. What about cluster management? How does that function? Which items are critical and which are not? Take actions when monitoring the critical management points are deviating. Evaluation of effects of actions. You can determine for yourself that it looks like hurt health, but in a little bit different way, and they're using different terms. And why is that? Because this is a what they call hazard analysis, critical control points approach, HACCP approach, in all quality programs which are certifiable. Hurt health programs are not certifiable in the whole chain. These programs, when implemented, are. Protocols are everywhere. Planes, hospitals, surgery departments of hospitals. Protocols, what to do, when, and why. Often used as checklist as well. And if it's done, you check it off. This is the implementation procedure in one view. Other health, milking process or claw health, it makes no difference. We're talking about the domain where hazards, where disorders, disease can occur. You determine that, which is important in that farm, which measures, which are the strong points and weak points. Think about the monitoring. We find the strong points and the weak points. We set limits and tolerance. That's, of course, like in other health. What is the target for clinical mastitis on a monthly or yearly basis? Where is it measured? Well, if you are talking about teeth end callosity monitoring, of course, it's measured in the milking parlor. Corrective measures, evaluation, verification. You need records. And say once a year or once 6 months, an audit to get an overall view and see what progress or lack of progress has been established. In fact, nothing new with respect to the hurt health programs, but it's much more formalized and structured and organized. One production process, the young stock rearing in as a whole. Each box has its own, what they call here, highlights, but in fact, there are important issues in that specific box, like here, the colostrum management. Every box may have its own specific requirements, evaluation parameters, and hence monitoring parameters. It's not difficult. There are books available, recently published, about the application of this type of process with ample examples from the field. This is the same where the monitoring issues are listed, on the basis of which you can design a monitoring protocol and the goals can be established with the farmer. A simple example of hazards and risk factors, Listeria in the milk as a hazard, or Staph aureus mastitis. Some major risk factors. Some are the same, and others are very specific. When they are the same, you can put them in a more general dairy management code of practice. FAO, OIA have developed the good agricultural practices. It's available. Based on that, it's not very difficult to determine good medicine application code of practice, or good hygiene practice, or good colostrum practice. Talking about the importance of risk is based on this simple formula, probability of occurrence and the effect level. Low probability, high effect, high probability, low effect, and everything what is in between those two. That's to determine importance, which to address first. You can have many methods to determine it. For example, starting from epidemiology, risk ratios. This comes from industrial domains, adaptive conjoint analysis. Ideal to use it to determine in a certain country or region, for example, what are farmers considering most important for animal welfare, dairy cattle welfare, and what are vets thinking about that. It's a very nice and easy tool which you can put on the internet, and the farmers can do it either by themselves on the internet or with the help of a vet. And the vet does it on the internet as well. Have to keep in mind, this is a very nice method. Expert opinion, then we come closely to the qualitatively issue. Educated guess. If you know the farm, if you know farms in general in the region, you have a kind of educated guess. If you're not sure, you can always ask colleagues or someone from a faculty, for example, a vet school, to assist in establishing that. This was already in 2006 in the World Bioethics Congress in France. These are the monitoring points that we found in herd health programs, and now suddenly we call them critical management factors, and these are specific critical management factors. And what is specific? Because they are objectively measurable. Well, these are much less or not. This is a yes-no situation, black and white. If we have those, they are much more predictive than the other ones. In industrial processes, this is the only one that is accepted. In several countries, different types of quality risk management programs are already implemented by force, by dairy plants, for example, or by farmers themselves. In Japan, Hokkaido, HACCP, like QRM, are being implemented. We should not underestimate the impact of retailers and consumer organizations, which put a force and a pressure on the farming community. We better be proactive in that than following too late. Focus, finally, is on certification of the farm. Again, protocols are paramount in that respect. Event logs, often used also in herd health program, what's going wrong, disorders, diseases are there, and audits. The principle of this application is that prevention is economically always more profitable than curing. So the better thing is to integrate both of them, knowing that herd health and productivity management is more like a freestyle execution, while at the other hand, this is formalized, organized, structured, and planned. A more analytical type of approach. How does it contribute to sustainability? This was another WBC Congress, and I just pick out one slide. This is the core business, and as you can see, reproduction, health and welfare, management, housing, barn climate. We have our role to play here. After this conference, a paper had appeared, published, where this is approached in much more detail. This is the area where we can play a role. The management planning with protocols, nutrition, reproduction, herd health, productivity management in general. In the Netherlands, for example, the farmers' association have defined priorities. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, with the emphasis at the first place on a more reduced, a justified use of antibiotics. This conference, there are several papers addressing that. 2017. So things are on the move, slowly but gradually. So in conclusion, Mr. Chairman, dear colleagues, the two have many things in common, but as I told you, the QRM is much more formalized, organized, planned and structured, more professional way of approach. But they can be integrated into one program. They require new knowledge and skills of the vet. Think about the psychological issues of coaching, of perception, of body language. Body language is not difficult. You only have to know some tips and tricks to find out who is doing what and why. It's obvious if I stand talking to you like this, I'm not very interested in you. If I'm doing a farm visit and all the time my cell phone is ringing, the farmer is next to me, I say, wait a minute, I answer my cell phone, that means that the guy at the other end of the line is more important than the farmer. That's denigrating. It's your client. He should have the priority. During a farm visit, you are not answering a phone. I'm finishing.
Dr. Noto hasn't already time's up, yeah. So could That's you conclude?
Thank you for your attention.